Hey everyone, I'm Alex, Video Productions Director here at Christ United. Welcome, thank you for joining us. I have a few quick announcements to share with you all before we get services started today. Are you a third grader, or is there a third grader in your life that you absolutely adore? We'll be presenting third grade Bibles in both traditional and modern worship August 15th at 11 a.m. Registration is required, so head over to cumc.com/Bible to get started. Middle school missions are gonna be awesome this summer. We will travel to different local mission sites each day to serve and end each day with fellowship. Registration is still open, so if you haven't signed up yet, now is the time. Visit cumc.com/msm to get started. If you have any questions regarding service today, reach out to one of our volunteers in the lobby, or if you're online, please send an email to cumc@cumc.com.
Hello, Christ United family. Don Underwood here, and it's great to be with you again.
Mike.
Chris Dowd has asked me to take on a little job in addition to that of Pastor Emeritus, because I have been known amongst the staff members as an early adapter of technology, and they've generally come to me for advice and counsel when it came to more important, highly sophisticated technological issues. Chris has invited me to be the chief technology officer here at Christ United. And so today in my new position, I'd like to share some thoughts with you about how to use the new QR codes that will be in your bulletin this coming Sunday morning. Now, this is very simple. Everybody knows what a QR code is. A QR stands for quick response. QR stands for quick response, and it's really, really handy. You can get a lot of information, and you can get a lot of functionality using a QR code. So on Sunday, when you get into your pew, you find your bulletin, you'll find this QR code, and then in order to utilize it, you need to pull out your phone and bring up your camera. It's really simple. So this is what you do. You got your camera, you got your QR code, and you kind of zero in on that QR code, and then, what did I do now? Oh, yeah. You zero in on that QR code, and then there should be a little button there on the top of your phone, and you click it, and when you do, a web page will open where you can register your attendance and also make a generous gift. I think you'll find this to not only be fascinating technology, but really, really helpful to you in registering your attendance at church and really helpful to us as well. In case you have any problems on Sunday, I'm going to have all sorts of assistant technology officers available to help you. The ushers and greeters and others will be able to help you both before, during, and after the service. And I look forward to seeing you in worship this coming Sunday morning.
Had this really great idea.
Yeah, it is great. So no quotes.
No okay. quotes. I no thought quotes. You were just the pastor of like good ideas, though.
Oh no, I'm great.
Okay.
I'm elevated.
I'm glad we can promote ourselves.
So I was thinking.
Okay.
What if we had a
ready
women's like a day retreat? So like
what?
Yeah. So I was thinking like it's been a really hard year.
Yeah.
Let's get them together.
Yeah.
We could have like worship. We could have like breakout groups, and then like they could learn about like mission opportunities and how to get plugged in.
Right, break it. Hold on. Like a women's event.
Yes.
That we do one day and we like invite everyone.
Yes.
I have amazing news for you.
Okay.
You know, all those meetings you've been just declining since you've been on vacation?
Yeah.
We have put one together. Look at this.
Oh.
Yeah.
That looks pretty.
Yeah, so we're doing one on August 21st.
That's okay.
That wasn't what you were thinking?
I was thinking this weekend.
Oh, okay, no, it is actually taking us months to plan. We're like super pumped about it.
Oh.
So,
okay.
do you think you could get on board with this one though? We're gonna have a speaker. Her name is Dr. Kelly Jameson. She's gonna come talk about self-care.
Okay.
We were really hoping that you would give us a fun and encouraging message.
I'll try.
Okay. So we hope that you guys will actually come to the event. It's on August 21st. It's called Refresh.
Ooh.
And it's from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. And guess what? Childcare is included. And so if you've got your kiddos, bring them along. It's $60 for the whole event for the whole day. So we're gonna have a lot of fun. It's gonna be great.
Yeah, so sign up.
Sign up at cumc.com/refresh. Or you can grab one of these flyers. And we've got these fancy QR codes that I know Don told you all about.
Yep.
So you can use that to get all signed up. And we hope to see you there.
Together, and that's what is inspiring other people to bring us all together in God's love. I saw the work of God when we went to sing at the Assisted Living Center today, because a lot of these people haven't had a ton of outside connection with people, and it was so great to just spread the word of God through our voices and just getting to talk to some of the people today.
Well, performing at the Living Center was really a fun experience for me, because you just got to see all of the people who have been really stuck in that one place for like some period of time. Not a lot of contact with other people. And so being able to go there and bring that joy to them and just seeing their faces light up, it was such a fun experience.
So at the Mariah House, I thought it was really cool what the mission was, and also you could tell how much like an impact we made on the people that we sang there. It was just really cool, and how, you know, how much they enjoyed those songs.
At the baseball game, just being there, standing in front of that whole stadium, it was kind of breathtaking just to be performing and to have everybody be able to hear what we have to say. It was really wonderful.
It was so cool to see our youth share their gifts this week, and especially today we went to the Mariah House, which was a home for women and children in situations where they just need to find and have a place of their own, and it was just neat. We have sung for larger crowds this week, but the crowd there was so appreciative of just the connection of the space that the youth were able to share, the ministry they were able to bring. It was just a joy to be there in the moment where our youth were ministering the gifts that they were given, sharing the gifts that God had for them to share this week.
Okay, so I loved our performance at the Mariah House, and what really stuck out to me was at the end, they asked to pray for us, and that was just like the bow on the trip, because we don't often go to places that ask to pray for us, and that was just really special and really meaningful, because it made me realize that although they're changing our lives and we get to go and help them, they're also impacted by what we do. So that was just really special to me.
Oh, Well, good morning. My name is Reagan Gilliland. I'm the pastor of adult discipleship here at Christ United. I'm delighted that you're joining us, whether in person or through streaming. We're so thankful for all the different ways we can reach people, whether they're in town or out of town. And so we're just glad that you are here, no matter how you are here this morning. We are starting a two-week series called Huh? Oh Yeah. That I'll be preaching, because today we're going to look at a familiar story of David and Goliath, and then next week we're going to look at a character that's a little bit more obscure. But again, we're glad you're here. We had a great choir tour, and we have so much coming up in the next few weeks, including the women's retreat that I hope that you will sign up for. So at this time, let us prepare our hearts and minds for worship.
Good morning. I'm Jason Bishop, Director of Music and Worship here at Christ United. Would you rise now, if you're able, and join us in our call to worship? Strength is commanding the wind and sea to obey, or wielding a slingshot in the face of a raging giant. Strength is accepting vulnerability from inside the boat, or standing in solidarity with the powerless. Strength is turning a cheek or loving an enemy. We come to worship a God who redefines our vision of strength. Amen.
Please join in the singing of our opening hymn, number 110, A Mighty Fortress Is Our God.
Care Ministry Director of Christ United, I invite you to join in our affirmation of faith as projected on the screen. Let us now confess our faith together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated.
So I want to begin this morning by telling a story that happened to me in January of 2015. I was up for my big P&Q interview, preparations and qualifications, one of your biggest interviews in your process to become an ordained Methodist pastor. Now, to get to this point, you've gone through a series of meetings and telling your story to people, interviewing. You first interview with your local church kind of council, and then you move on to DCOM, which is District Committee on Ministry, and you do that a couple of times. And then to get to this point, you submit a lot of paperwork. You answer these very foundational, difficult theological questions, and so you end up submitting about 30 to 35 pages just on that. And then you submit two sermons and a Bible study, and you write out your call story and lots of other papers, and you gather references from people, your transcripts from different schools, and just a lot of files. But before you can submit all your final paperwork, you have to make sure that other people are looking over it. And so you send your paperwork out to clergy so they can put notes on it in that very friendly red pen, take this out or add this, or I don't know what you mean by this. And then you get your final paperwork, and then you turn it all in, and then before you go for your interview, it's very wise to do some mock interviews with clergy, so they can kind of get you an idea of what questions may be asked at this interview. So then you travel up to the Prothero Center, which is up in Pottsboro, Texas, and you meet with the Board of Ordained Ministry, or BOM. And there's three different rooms that you rotate through, because there's usually three candidates that are being interviewed at a time. In each room, there's about 10 to 15 clergy and lay that will ask you whatever they want. Clarification, again, on paperwork, or I didn't agree with this, or why did you say this, or how did you feel about this, or what would you do in this instance? To say that it's nerve-wracking would be an understatement. Mike knows this as well. We've all been through it. And so we get to this interview, and I failed to mention that another one of the candidates is my husband, who's interviewing at the exact same time. So we go through the rooms, and then when you're all done, you go sit in the main lodge, and you sit, and you wait as the board discusses if you're ready or not, if you're going to pass or not. And so through the glass doors, I can see a few of the board members coming, and they take Scott, my husband, and the other candidate, and they go one way, and then I go this other way and take a hard left. And I know, I've been told, because I've had enough people go through, if you go to that room, that means you didn't pass. More on that in a little bit. The story of David and Goliath is one that most likely is pretty familiar to us. We've all read it at least briefly or heard it as a child, and we know the term Goliath is kind of this term we use. That person is my Goliath, that project is my Goliath, whatever it may be. We know the story. It's a little shepherd boy. He defeats this big, scary giant with a slingshot, right? Looked just like this, actually. And we're like, it's a good story. The underdog takes down this huge, massive, giant warrior. But then a few years ago, Malcolm Gladwell, the author, released a book called David and Goliath. And he kind of unpacked that maybe Goliath wasn't as scary as we first thought, that there were some things about him that maybe made it a little bit easier to actually defeat him. It's a wonderful book. He also has a great TED Talk if you're like, I don't have time to read another book. But if you watch the TED Talk by Malcolm Gladwell, you kind of get a sense of what he's saying. But I'm not going to talk about that either, because when I started reading this story again, I got a different lesson out of it. And so we're going to be in 1 Samuel chapter 17. And I know in your bulletin there's quite a few verses. I'm not going to read all of them because the first time I ran my sermon, it was running almost 30 minutes long. And I thought, I need to cut something. So I'm going to summarize some of the verses. But we're going to start in verse 4, and then I'll kind of walk you through the story. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs, a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and his shield bearer went before him. So pretty impressive introduction of Goliath. We get an idea of probably how intimidating he truly was. Now we skip down to verse 12. Now David was the son of an Ephrathite of Bethlehem in Judah named Jesse, who had 8 sons. In the days of Saul, the man was already old and advanced in years. Okay, not very impressive. It doesn't have this long description of who David is, what he's bringing to the table. So then it goes on, as we read, it talks about his brothers, and we find out that David originally came to give some food to his brothers. In fact, this isn't going to be on the screen, but he brings 10 loaves and then also 10 cheeses. So I'm thinking that David invented the charcuterie board with breads and cheeses. Thank you. The first two services I told that joke, not a single laugh. So good for you for actually getting the joke. So David isn't showing up. He's not there to fight Goliath. That was not his original intention when he shows up. But he realizes, okay, there's this giant that's mocking and talking smack and saying, like, who can come fight me? You know, I'm so great. So then David's like, well, I guess I'll give it a shot. And the people are like, I don't know if this is a good idea. But this is what David says, jumping down to verse 34. But David said to Saul, your servant used to keep sheep for his father, and whenever a lion or bear came and took a lamb from the flock, I went after it and struck it down, rescuing the lamb from its mouth, and if it turned against me, I would catch it by the jaw, strike it down, and kill it. Your servant has killed both lions and bears, and this uncircumcised Philistine shall be like one of them, since he has defied the armies of the living God. David said, the Lord who saved me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear will save me from the hand of this Philistine. So Saul said to David, go, and may the Lord be with you. Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them. So David removed them. Then he took his staff in his hand. He chose 5 smooth stones from the wadi and put them in the shepherd's bag in the pouch. His sling was in his hand, and he drew near to the Philistine. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So we know after this that he approaches Goliath. He doesn't get super close to him. He takes his slingshot. Did not look like this. It's a sling. And he whips it around. And one stone hits him through right here. And he falls down. And then in a turn of events, David runs over, takes Goliath's own sword, and chops off his head. It's a great bedtime Bible story for your children. But none of us are like, I did not see that coming. So, you know, Goliath is introduced as this big warrior, because he is. I mean, everything that he is wearing, it says, so he's 6 cubits in a span, comes out to 9 feet and 9 inches approximately. He's got the bronze helmet. He's got this coat that weighs 5,000 shekels, which is roughly 125 pounds. And then he's got bronze on his legs, this javelin. The spear of the javelin weighs 15 pounds. And then, of course, he has a sword. And then we have sweet little David. Not very impressive. Doesn't have armor. He's got a sling. So we see a contrast. But it's funny, when you first read it, if you didn't know who David was, you might even think, well, I don't need to remember his name. I don't think he's going to do anything important. Because Goliath, he's the champion. He's been mocking. He's been waiting for 40 days for someone to challenge him. But I imagine some soldiers, some very overconfident soldiers, had tried to battle him. I'm sure this wasn't the first battle that Goliath had been in. But the thing is, a lot of these men probably did the same thing over and over again. And it made me think about all the times that I've tried the same thing over and over again, expecting different results, only to find I have the same outcome. Or how maybe we can get comfortable, we get stuck in our ways, we start to coast, or maybe we just really think it's our ways, our ideas, our practices, our tricks, that's what's going to work. I'll say a little bit more about that later too. But the part of the story that really just grabbed my attention was verses 38 through 40, when Saul gives his armor to David. Now, I don't know a lot about armor, but I know that if you have proven yourself, most likely, if you've had high ranks, you've been in battle before, that you probably have pretty good armor. And why it's good is because it's fit for you. You don't want armor that's too big because it's too heavy, like David, or too small, or have gaps in it, or at loose fitting, because then you're vulnerable to injury. So you want good armor for you. You want it fitted for you. Which is why I think it's so funny that Saul thinks, well, I'm a grown man. This armor should be great for David, this young boy. There's actually this great painting from the Morgan Bible of him, David, trying to stand up with the armor. I think it looks like those inflatable things at car dealerships, you know, like when they lose air and they're like, I can't stand up. That's David. Way too heavy for him. But I think there's something communicated when Saul gives his armor to David. And that's what I want to really talk about today. I think essentially Saul is saying three things to David. And maybe we have heard similar messages like this as well. The first thing, it has always worked for me, so it'll work for you. Two, this is who you should be. And three, this is what makes you a winner. So the first, it's always worked for me, so it'll work for you. Essentially, when we hear that kind of phrase, or what Saul is saying even, is like, I know how to go about this problem. I know what to do. I know how to fix it. And for us, it's very easy or tempting to tell people what to do based on our expertise, on our experience. But what I'm finding is that just because something worked for us doesn't necessarily mean it worked for someone else. For one thing, we're all very different. We're all unique. Now, I know that there's probably things or situations that no matter what time it is or where we are in life, our expertise, our experience is helpful, but that's not always the case. I also know that times have changed. What worked 30 years ago, or 15 years ago, or 5 years ago may not work. And so we have to be careful about how much we interject or shoot down new ideas. Because there's plenty of paths, there's ways of life, or perspectives, or ways about solving problems that I don't understand, or that I don't even agree with. But I know that when we expect people to behave or do things just like we have, it's not helpful. And sometimes the old way is not the best way. And more importantly, we have to allow the Holy Spirit to do something new. When I think about doing the same thing over and over again, or saying, well, that's the way we did it, so it should work for you. In the church, we're very guilty of this. We want new people, we want new things to happen, but we keep going about it the same way, and we're wondering, like, why is there not new people here? Why aren't things changing or growing? And so I love that David in this story tells Saul essentially, like, that's not going to work for me. That's not going to work for me. He listens to this leading and he knows how he's gifted and how he's equipped. And so for us, not only do we need to be listening to God's leading, but also to other people's new ideas, new ways, new perspectives, and new voices. Okay, the second thing. This is who you should be. Now I'm raising two young kids right now. I've got a 5-year-old daughter and a 2-year-old son. And already for my 5-year-old, not so much my 2-year-old, but already for my 5-year-old, I'm like, do I have her in the right activities? Am I setting up for failure? Picking which kindergarten she could go to was very stressful. So already, I'm already kind of consumed with, okay, I need her to be a certain way because I see who I want her to be. So therefore, let's work backwards. I need to make sure she's doing this, she's involved in that. I have to build her a resume. Again, she's 5. And I'm already kind of like, okay, I want to make sure she's exactly who I want her to be. But did you know, this may be shocking to you, that kids come out and they just are who they are, right? Or if you have multiple kids, you know that they can all be radically different. And I think about how often we try to, especially with kids, say, okay, I want you to be this way, and so I'm going to make sure you're in this and don't do that because I know who you need to be. And we even do that to other people, to friends, maybe to our spouse, to our parents, to other family members. And I've come to realize how damaging that can be when we don't let people live into who God created them to be. Forcing them to be a certain way is not helpful, and it is certainly not loving. So I pray that we think about what we tell our kids, our spouses, our parents, our friends, and we let them be who they are. Now, I know there's a limit to that. When people are doing things that are damaging to them, you have to guide them. But I think, in general, there's something to be said for letting people who they are, not forcing what we want. Okay, third. This is what will make you a winner. This is closely related to this is who you should be, but for a moment, I want you to picture someone. When I say, think of someone who is very successful, does someone come to mind? Do we have a picture? Or maybe I say, who are the really important people in the world? Who do you think the world uplifts? So I think there's something about the way we've been trained to envision who is successful and who is a winner. Often they look a certain way, they act a certain way, they have the same kind of accomplishments, the same sort of acolytes and degrees and whatnot. And so when we start telling people, children, okay, this is who you need to be because I need you to be this, they kind of get boxed in. And so there's people that grow up and they think, well, I don't check all those boxes, so I guess I'm not successful, or I'm not important, or I'm not worth respecting, or I'm not worth listening to because I don't fit your mold of who is a winner. People are left feeling really unworthy and like they're not good enough. And there are a lot of brilliant and amazing and hardworking people that don't check all the boxes, but they have incredible value. And so it pains me to think about how many people have probably we've looked down upon because of who they are, what they look like, what they've done or not done, where they live, what school they went to, what neighborhood they live in, what car they drive, where they go on vacation, etc., etc. And that's why I love this story of David. It's because he looks at that armor and he says, no. No. That's great. It worked for you, but it's not me. It's not going to work. And what's really even more beautiful is that, you know, we heard how David defeated lions and bears and all of that. But he realizes that's also not going to work in this situation. So even what I've done in the past, what has worked, is not going to work right now. And so he changes and realizes, I'm going to use a sling. He leans into what he is good at, what he knows he has a skill at. And the sling is, it's again, it is not like this. It's a very powerful weapon. Slingers in war were a game changer because they could be far away. And if they had a lot of accuracy, they could take down people. And that's exactly what he did. So when he whips it around, the rock, which is very dense, is going about 80 miles an hour and has the same damage of a 45 millimeter handgun. It's nothing to be messing around with. But I love that he realizes, okay, I know what God has equipped me with, and I'm not going to listen to anyone else. Because I'm sure Saul and the other soldiers and the brothers were like, I don't know if this is going to work. This doesn't seem like a good idea. And so they sit and they watch. And sure enough, he takes him down. David took time to think about what made him unique, and he didn't try to put on anyone else's armor. I think it's a really powerful story for us. I also love that it mentions how David had 5 stones in his pouch. And it made me think about the 5 things that make me, me. What about the 5 things that make you, you? What are those 5 things? I'm sure you have more, but what about at least 5 things that make you unique, that you know that you are good at, that you are equipped with? Or what are your 5 values? How do you hold on to those? You know that those are yours and yours alone. I think it's important for us to figure out what those are. So back to not passing my interview. It was a super fun time, by the way, just great. So they say it's not a no, it's a not yet, and they can sugarcoat it all they want, but it's hard, it's embarrassing, because you tell everyone to pray for you as you're going for your interview, and then you have to call and text one by one, and then it passed. And of course, my husband had to go and do really good and pass, right? Super fun car ride home, right? I'm like, I'm so happy for you. I said, you know, it's great. But, you know, I didn't do super great in my interview, but the thing that really, I think, hurt me is that I went in, you know, and I had done the mock interviews and I had talked to plenty of people, and a lot of them said, okay, make sure you say this. Make sure you come across like this. This is what they want to hear. If you really want to be taken seriously, make sure you say this. And so I had memorized lines and things like, this is who I want to be and this is what kind of leader I am. And it was all completely false. But I convinced myself I needed to put on someone else's armor and walk in and be that person. And I think the board saw through it. So it took you have to wait a whole another year until you can go up again. And I went back 3 weeks after having my first child, very sleep deprived, still on pain medicine, still not able to stand up straight, but I passed. Clearly I passed, otherwise I probably wouldn't be up here. But I passed because I walked in and I was me. I leaned into who I was and I talked about what I believed and how I felt like God was uniquely calling me and what gifts I had for the church. I didn't feed him a line. I didn't try to be anyone else. I was just me. See, the voices of Saul are strong, they're loud, and they're everywhere. And they tell us to do that, be that, act like this, become that. Oh, don't be that. Don't become like that. The list goes on and on. But I hope that we can drown out that voice. And that when we see that Goliath, when that Goliath is in front of us, that we realize we only need to be ourselves and no one else. And that we take off anyone else's armor. We take our 5 stones and we aim. Amen.
come now to the time where we uplift our tithes and offerings. And again, we're glad you're here, and the best way that you can help us know that you're here is by, if you're online, if you comment or like, or if you're in service, you can zap your QR code if you didn't sign in and let us know. Also, through that QR code, you can go to our giving. Online, you can also go to cumc.com/give, where you can set up a one-time gift or a reoccurring gift. Again, we just had choir tour. We've got the women's retreat coming up, and we just have a lot that's going to be kicking off this fall. And all of it is possible because of your generosity. And so we thank you so much for the ways that you continue to show up, help out, and that you're present. Your support and your encouragement is much needed and much appreciated. So thank you again for your generosity.
Come now to our time for prayers of the people, and after each prayer is read this morning, I invite you to respond with the words, "Lord, hear our prayer." And remember, you can go online to submit your prayers as well at cumc.com/prayer. So let us now pray for our church and for the world. Holy and loving God, grant that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, may live together in your love, and reveal your glory in the world. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Guide the people of this land and of all the nations in your ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Give us all a reverence and respect for your earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources wisely in the service of others, and especially to your honor and glory. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Bless all those whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as Christ loves us. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer. Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them your courage, your peace, and your hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. In your mercy, Lord, hear our prayer.
We now pray together as Jesus taught all his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I invite you to stand once again as you're able and join us in our closing hymn, number 580, Lead On, O King Eternal.
May be seated. So I just wanted to say a quick note of those that have been volunteering and helping us make Sunday morning happen. For a while there, we had just a handful that was holding down the fort, and we're just so grateful to them. As many of you are starting to come back more, we would love for you to serve on Sunday morning, even if it's one Sunday a month. You can greet, you can pass a plate, you can count. Also at the 8:45 service, if you ever come to that, you can help with communion. There's just so many different ways for you to serve, but we are so thankful. We can't make our services happen without you. So if you're interested in that, you can contact Lisa Booth to get on that schedule. So the best thing that you can ever do, or the best thing you can ever be, is your most authentic self. I think we sometimes think, well, I have to be someone, or maybe they don't like me, but being you is a really beautiful and wonderful thing because God created you that way. So as we go out into the world, be you, because the world needs someone like you and no one else. Amen.
The Lord bless and keep.